Like many Americans, Barbara Norden, a freelance editor and writer in Charlottesville, Virginia, often procrastinates.
I knew that professionally I needed a website, and I'd had the domain name, I made lists of what I needed to put on it for eons.
But in 2012, she learned about an online program that would push her to get the project done, or else she would lose $50. It's an example of behavioral economics at work, according to Dean Carlin, a Yale University economist.
It's about realizing that you're going to respond to incentives, and if you don't like the way you're going to respond, you can change those incentives. You can change the price of things by being a bit self-aware and thinking ahead.
Understanding how people respond to incentives is central to behavioral economics, a field which looks at the psychology behind economic decisions. This new science is being used to help people, nudge them, on everything from making better healthcare decisions to maximizing energy efficiency. But one of its biggest uses is in improving people's financial choices, an area in which many Americans don't excel. The personal savings rate is less than half of what it was a generation ago, and an estimated 56 million Americans have virtually no retirement savings.
Financial education has actually had not great results in terms of getting people to change behavior.
Josh Wright is the executive director of Ideas 42, a nonprofit that works with companies, foundations, and governments to apply lessons from behavioral economics. He points to a study that showed how committing to save more, not even today, but in the future, dramatically increased retirement savings.
One of the interesting things about people's financial lives is they usually know what they want to do, or they have an intention to save more or spend less, get greater control over their finances. And a lot of it has to do with following through on those desires and intentions. And there's a lot that behavioral science can do along with technology to help us help people help themselves really to do what they want to do.
And new businesses have taken some of these insights to heart. Washington, D.C.-based Hello Wallet provides financial computer software, including budgeting and retirement tools, for employees of big companies across the country.
So we serve manufacturers, we serve the people who are putting ketchup in the Heinz bottles, as well as we serve investment bankers, and quite the range in between.
Steve Wendell is a behavioral researcher and principal scientist at Hello Wallet. He got his PhD in political science, studying voter behavior, and he's written a book about using behavioral economics to create products that appeal to consumers.
What is a scientist doing at a personal finance software company?
I help identify what are the behavioral obstacles that people face, come up with ideas on how to help them overcome those obstacles, and then I test them. Test and see, does this actually help people? Does this actually put more money in the bank account over time? So, bottom line, are we helping people?
One test Wendell devised looked at the effect of competition on financial behavior by creating peer comparisons.
We said, okay, we'll have one version where all you get is your current score, one version where you get nothing, and another version where you get this peer comparison. So you see not only your score, but you see how other people like you are doing.
It turns out that people who were shown the peer comparison saved hundreds more in a one-month test.
So does knowing that score or what your neighbor's score is help everyone
solve
their?
No. There is no silver bullet in the behavioral world. The thing we always remember is that people are different. Right? Our experiences are different. And so our goal with Hello Wallet is to adapt to the individual, meet them where they are.
But it's not all about providing positive incentives or carrots when it comes to helping people make better decisions. Stick.com is an internet company co-founded by economist Dean Carlin in 2007. It provides a stick, or negative incentive, to influence behavior. It's one of a handful of companies, including BeeMinder and Healthy Wage, that provide an online platform, turning goals into what are known as commitment contracts. With Stick, users put money on the line for any goal, from trying to lose weight to saving more money each week, and can designate a referee to oversee their progress.
Basically, what the research showed is that, hey, money talks. And when you've got your money on the line and you put your money where your mouth is, you're much more likely to achieve your goal.
Jordan Goldberg co-founded Stick with Carlin and another professor when he was an MBA student at Yale. He says the financial stick makes long-term goals easier to reach.
So we're literally raising the price of your vice, of your poor behavior, raising the price of failure so that you'll make the right decision today.
If you fail to meet your goal, you lose the money. It goes to someone you've designated, an anonymous charity, or you can choose an anti-charity, a cause that you don't believe in.
So for instance, if you're pro-gun control and you don't succeed, we send your money to the NRA or vice versa.
Barbara Norden chose an anti-charity when she used Stick to motivate her to build her own website. Her choice, a political PAC she doesn't support.
Stick.com has helped me just over and over, just thinking, I do not want so-and-so to get my $50.
Norden has become an avid Stick user, creating goals for everything from keeping up with chores to writing more each day.
Why couldn't you do that on your own? What was stopping you from doing that? And how did Stick really make
you do it? It was always so easy to just put it off a little longer, whatever the excuse was. So Stick.com raises that kind of accountability to a formal money on the line kind of level. Of course, you don't have to put money on the line, but my feeling is like, what's the point if there's not a real Stick involved?
Stick co-founder Dean Carlin and a fellow economist know just what she's talking about. They once agreed to each pay the other half a year's salary if they regained weight they had previously lost.
So half the income, that's like thousands of dollars?
Yeah, we wanted to make it so that it was painful. It had to be. Otherwise, if you fail, there's a risk that you fail and you just kind of strike it up to kind of the cost of an expensive dinner or even a vacation. But it had to be enough bite that we knew that we would do it and that it would be painful. But it couldn't be so much money that we couldn't physically write the check.
His friend did eventually regain the weight and paid Carlin $15,000.
And it surprised a lot of people, but he, you know, I made him pay and he paid.
So is that kind of the key to the way Stick works? I mean, that it has to be painful enough for each individual person?
That is exactly the idea. The key to Stick really is one of being self-aware. What is the right amount that is enough that you'll be honest with yourself if you fail, be able to pay it if you fail, but enough so that it'll actually motivate you to change.
While Carlin is no longer involved with Stick, he still regularly incorporates insights from behavioral economics into his everyday life.
When we order dessert, I just want one bite. You eat the rest, but I want one bite, no more. If I ask for a second bite, I owe you $100.
Devising ways to motivate change, whether to drop more pounds or to save more money.